Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. You know what? I've always wondered about evolutionary developmental biology. Let's see where I can find out a little bit more about that. Here we go. Evolutionary developmental biology. Let's have a look here. Kristen Panfilio from the University of Cologne in Germany. She's a postdoctoral research fellow at the University of Cologne and got her PhD at Cambridge University in the UK. And she got her bachelor's in biology in Pennsylvania in the US. If only I could magically transport myself to Germany and have a chat to her to learn some more. If I could interview her, this is probably how it would go. I've got Kristen Panfilio here from the University of Cologne, and she's a developmental geneticist. So, Kristen, firstly, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And secondly, could you explain what a developmental geneticist does?
I can try. Development can be very broad, has anything to do with life forms developing over the course of their lives. In my case, it usually means embryology, although it could mean later stages of development. So, for example, I look at what happens in an egg. If you have a butterfly, you also have the development from the caterpillar to the little pupa to the adult form as well. And then genetics has quite a broad meaning these days compared to classical genetics and anything having to do with molecular biology or with DNA, genes, etc.
Where did you get your interest from?
Well, I always liked biology in school, and at university we had three categories. We had small, medium, and big. And small meant things like microbiology, bacteria, or cell biology. And big meant things like ecology or behavior evolution. And I actually like the middle ground, which tends to be more like embryology, what I do, or physiology, things like that. But I really like, let's say, kind of one and a half, between one being the small and two being the middle, where you have some sort of information about the genes in the context of these larger systems like embryos.
Okay, so in terms of the genetics part of it, where does that come into the embryology? Why is studying the genetics important?
Well, actually, the genetics came first. We work on insects. They're extremely convenient to have in the lab because they're small, the generation time is short, you can get lots and lots of eggs from a single adult, things like this. And in working on insects, the major model system is the fruit fly, Drosophila melanogaster. Mm-hmm. And that was originally worked up for genetics, not for embryology at all.
And that was the one with the famous quote from the vice presidential candidate, Sarah Palin. Didn't she make a quote last year to
why
say,
are we funding why are we research on fruit flies?
Exactly.
So that's because it's one of the best systems known for genetics, going back to the 1920s, when normal fruit flies have red eyes, and they first found a strain that had white eyes, so a first mutant you could actually see. And for a while, I worked with some people in Indiana University in the U.S., and the person I was working with said, we have that strain down the corridor. When we teach undergraduates, we can actually say this is the original white-eyed strain that people first started studying to understand how genetic inheritance works and how traits get passed on from one generation to the next.
That'd be great for the students.
Amazing. And so that's been worked on for decades and decades. And then it was really only late 70s, early 80s, I suppose, that it started to turn towards embryology more in terms of what features they were looking at. Because it used to be that they were more looking at genetic traits they could find, mutants they could see with the adults. So the white eyes are in the adult stage, not in the egg stage, not in the larva stage, not in the pupa stage. And another classic one is that flies are dipterans in terms of their classification. That means two wings, and they were able to get some mutants that have four wings, for example.
Okay.
But again, wings are a trait that you see in the adults because the earlier stages don't fly at all.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's relatively recently that the developmental part kind of inserted itself in front of the genetics part.
Mm-hmm.
And the two had existed kind of side by side without interacting for a long time. So experimental embryology goes back even into mid, possibly late 19th century, but they didn't have any sort of genetic tools. They didn't know what a gene was. They didn't know how inheritance worked. So it was much more poking and prodding and, this bit sticks out. I wonder if I chop it off, what will happen here, sort of manipulations.
So it's almost reminiscent of around the Darwinian era, where he knew that there were traits passed on, but they had no idea about genetics at all.
Exactly. And then genetics sprang up when people started to be more aware of, say, Mendel's work on peas and different flower colors and other classic traits being inherited. And then with the work on Drosophila, this fruit fly, things really started to come together for genetics as a field. And people did embryology alongside of that, but it kind of got forgotten for a while. Mm-hmm. And it was only later, when it was possible to understand really how inheritance works, that people started to have the tools to go back and look at embryology again and start to understand things better. I guess you should say that my background is a bit bigger than developmental genetics. It's actually evolutionary developmental genetics, or a little bit easier to say, just Evo Devo for evolution and development. And so that also is a relatively young field, and that's quite interesting because it's now at a turning point. If you look at a mouse and you look at a fruit fly, they're animals, but they're completely different. One has a backbone, one doesn't, one has six legs, all of these very obvious differences. Mm-hmm. And so when people started to think about how things could be evolutionarily related, they didn't expect to find much. But when you start to look at the DNA and the genetics, you can really see what's behind the manifestation, the final adult form. And initially, everyone was utterly amazed at how similar everything is. Mm-hmm. So the degree of similarity at the DNA level, the A's and T's and G's and C's, is extremely high across most animals, going back hundreds of millions of years.
And even across animals and plants, there's a lot of similarities as well, aren't there?
And where you don't see that plants and animals are doing the same thing, you can see that they've taken the same toolkit and then kind of used them in different ways, but come out with maybe the same solution to a problem of how you accomplish some metabolic process or how you grow some part of your body, something like this.
So would a good analogy for that be, you have four colored Lego bricks, and I ask person one to build a tower and I ask person two to build a tower, totally independent of each other, and they'll both build towers that can stand upright, but they could be totally different, but they're made up of the same four fundamental Lego
Very
blocks.
Much so. And you can see that even at higher levels of organization, that it's not just the A, T, G, C, but even the particular genes, the particular proteins, the pathways those proteins are acting in are also very conserved. Mm-hmm. So one of the most now famous for Evo Devo examples is a set of genes called the Hox genes. And so maybe you remember I mentioned that with the fly mutants, they could make this four-winged fly. Mm-hmm. And that was because usually flies only have two wings. Most insects usually have four because they don't have a second set of wings. They have some other special adaptation. But with this mutant, the special adaptation was lost. So then they had kind of an atavistic reversion to having two sets of wings, where the one part of the body lost its normal information and it became like the other part of the body. And this is called a homeotic transformation, because homeotic, it looks similar to something that you get elsewhere. And so it's as if one bit of information has been copied over by another bit of information from elsewhere in the body. And these sorts of mutations were known from this classical genetics for years and years and years. And then it turns out that they all are affecting the same set of genes. And these genes are similar in a number of ways. They're all the same types of genes. They all have the same DNA sequence motif in them. And so then, for sure, after this homeotic notion, they're called Hox genes. And they're even located in the same bit of DNA when you look at the chromosomes, things like this. Mm-hmm. And what these genes do is they're kind of like beads on a string on the DNA. And as you go down the string and you hit the different beads, it's as if you're going down the body of the animal from head to tail. And so each of these different beads or each of these genes is giving specific information for a part of the body. And it tells you what will be the arms, what will be the belly, what will be the legs, or in the case of a fly, what will be wings and what will be not wings, things like this. And so it was amazing to understand this way that the body is made. It could have this sort of DNA genetic background for understanding development. But what blew everyone's minds was that this cluster of genes, these Hox genes, are absolutely conserved across all animals higher than sponges, effectively. And you can even find early indications of these genes in such primitive organisms. But this Hox cassette of genes to make the body from head to tail is conserved across flies and mice and many, many animals. And everyone was so astonished that it's not just ATGC, that's the same, but even this entire cassette of genes to give information in this particular way has been the same across so wide a spread of evolution.
And has this been discovered in gene sequences of animals that have since been extinct? So I know that recently that they managed to get some mammoth DNA and, mm-hmm. and so on. So these sorts of things were still discovered in
it
such
old... It certainly should be there, because mammoths would then be within... For the tree of life, they're not so far down the trunk. They're much more up in the branches, as it were.
No pun intended.
No, not at all, actually. And so, yeah, then to the extent you can recover DNA from such fossil material, then, yeah, those would definitely be there.
So for a non-geneticist, it seems to be quite an amazing fact that you can have... so many different types of creatures from fundamentally the same, not just the building blocks, but the same set of patterns as
mm-hmm,
well.
Mm-hmm.
Do we understand where these differences arise from
That's
the embryonic
stage?
That's actually
where the field is now. Everyone mm-hmm. was so amazed by the conservation, how similar everything was for a good couple of decades, that it was only a little bit later that people were like, oh yeah, okay, if everything's the same, then how do you get a body that looks completely different? So even just within invertebrates, you have insects, which by definition have six legs, and they're related to things like spiders with eight. But those are related to crustaceans, which have dozens and dozens of appendages, and they're all specialized. They've been described kind of like the Swiss Army knife of animals, because they have special antennae, special bits for feeding, for walking, for swimming, all of these things. And if they're all getting the same information from, say, these Hox genes, then where do the differences lie? And that's where it's now starting to get interesting and getting a bit more complicated, because then if you look at differences, you get, well, actually a lot of different answers.
Okay, so what are some of these...
Well, at first people thought, well, maybe it's more complicated if you have more genes, but that doesn't seem to be the case at all. And so now what people are looking at is not just the DNA itself, but what happens when you start to use the DNA. Because the DNA is just kind of the archive or the storehouse. It has all the information, and every cell of your body has a complete copy of the genome, but all the cells of your body aren't the same.
Mm-hmm.
So skin cells aren't the same as nerve cells, aren't the same as blood cells, for example. And the reason they're different is because the DNA is the same, but the way it's used is not. So you're only turning on certain genes in certain contexts. And the way that you turn genes on or turn them off is actually really complicated.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can have inhibitors, but you could have inhibitors of inhibitors. You can have some sort of chemical modification. You could say, stick a sugar on the end of one of your protein molecules, things like this. Maybe it needs a certain pH in the cell. There are a lot of physiological chemical differences that come up when you start to have things in motion that you wouldn't get just from reading the ATGC.
In my mind, it sounds like there's a lot of variables that go into this, but if we're going to take a step back to the evolutionary
mm-hmm.
development stuff,
mm-hmm.
there would have had to have been a point where there was this separation of development from one kind of creature,
mm-hmm.
let's say,
mm-hmm.
to another. So do we understand what those points are and what could have caused those changes?
Well, the question is on what scale. You have microevolution and you have macroevolution, and then you have a really big black hole between the two. Microevolution is a bit similar to population genetics, where you can see that different traits exist in different populations, maybe something like eye color, and some people have blue eyes, others brown eyes, and you can see certain groups of people are much more likely to have blue eyes. And you can track how changes and that sort of thing occur over time as populations mix or separate, things like that. Then you have the really big changes, like having different numbers of legs, and that it's a little bit harder to imagine. And so that's something that people have thought about for really quite some time, because for some traits, it seems like they have to be there fully formed or not at all. You can't really envision an in-between state. So you don't really think that between having eight legs in spiders and having six legs in insects, that there's something walking around with seven.
Mm-hmm.
Probably walk in circles or not walk very efficiently, right?
Yeah.
So that's actually really tricky. And that's something that people are really, really working on right now. And there isn't any single answer for that. But a lot of that can, in some cases, be traced back to genes, for example, yet again, and how they're regulated. So one example is that in certain insects like flies and butterflies, you have the larva or the caterpillar that is a crawling stage before you then have the cocoon, before you then have the adult.
Mm-hmm.
And what you can see is that with a fly maggot, not very nice to think about, it has no legs at all. It's just this simple little body. And caterpillars have many, many legs going all the way down the body, which is good for when they're crawling all over the plants.
In terms of regulating leg development between flies and butterflies, the case is that flies lack abdominal legs, while butterflies have abdominal prolegs. In both species, the genes that suppress leg development act in the same way, and the downstream target genes for making legs are subject to the activity of these suppressing HOX genes in both species. The difference, and the reason why butterflies have legs where flies don't, is because the repressor genes are themselves repressed, and therefore absent in the presumptive leg region in butterflies. So what would happen in that butterfly instance, mm-hmm. if that inhibitor was no longer inhibited? Would that butterfly...
No, the inhibition has been lost.
Okay.
So they can grow legs because the program's not being blocked. It's rather, I think, in the fly. It's the reverse situation where this sensitivity, so the program isn't actually enabled, isn't carried out.
Where I'm coming from with this question is, mm-hmm. if the caterpillar can continue to grow the legs, what happens if you modify that within the butterfly? Will the butterfly then grow more than six legs?
The butterflies are fine. They have lost the ability to block making legs.
If the differences are due to some of these inhibitors and, mm-hmm. and blocking and so on, which causes some of these physiological differences in creatures, mm-hmm. if you tweak them in one particular creature or another, can you change what their physical manifestation is going to end up being?
Yes, you can. Mm-hmm.
And has that been successfully done so far, or is that a very complex process?
Well, it depends on what you consider successful. You can make a lot of things, such as going back to these classical mutants, and they can develop to adulthood, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they're capable of reproducing. So then you get
That's another complication, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Because mm-hmm. you end up with sterile creatures, mm-hmm. and then the question is, how did this occur in nature so mm-hmm. that they weren't sterile?
Right. But if you're looking at the maggot or the caterpillar stage, whether you have legs or not, it's not likely to be 100% lethal.
Mm-hmm.
And because the body of the caterpillar or the maggot gets changed completely during the cocoon stage before you get the adult, you can, in a way, for this context, kind of undo what you're seeing there.
Mm-hmm.
But you could, on the other hand, understand that if you're going to crawl around on a tree and eat leaves, it's advantageous to have little legs
mm-hmm.
so you can get around. On the other hand, fly larvae tend to burrow into the flesh of fruit, and so it's actually not an advantage to have legs. You can see them getting in the way of this little burrowing, mm-hmm. almost worm-like shape. And so to the extent that having little legs or not having little legs helps you better adapt to your ecological niche,
mm-hmm.
it is an advantage. So maybe if you were a maggot trying to burrow into fruit and you had these little legs getting in the way, you would not be as good at eating the fruit. So maybe you don't get to be big enough to make yourself into a pupa, into a cocoon, as quickly or as efficiently. So then you could imagine that those that didn't have the little legs over time would be more successful.
Mm-hmm.
And so it wouldn't be an all or nothing switch. It would rather be over time, the frequency of one group in the population would increase.
Yep.
And to the extent that they have this fitness advantage, it would continue that way.
Sounds like to understand this area, you need to understand a combination of evolutionary principles, developmental biology, and the genetics all at once.
I do like it that way. I thought that this would be great as a field for doing research because I would never get specialized. And of course, I know that never turns out to be true. But I do like that you do have this sort of mix. And the previous lab I was in was really fun because people came at it from all sorts of perspectives. You had people coming in who were pure molecular geneticists. They wanted to know the tree of life from DNA. So they wanted to get their hands on as many DNA samples from as many creatures as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And you had other people coming in with a background in paleontology and actually looking at tadpoles or other very primitive early embryonic development stages
mm-hmm.
From the fossil record. And so you could really tell when somebody new arrived in the lab because they didn't quite have this interdisciplinary language, but
mm-hmm.
everyone is able to really contribute a new perspective, which is really fun.
So what is the specific area of research that you're looking at the moment?
Well, I started out being very interested in these Hox genes. Mm-hmm. And in vertebrates, it's very easy. They're numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way up to about 13, where 1 is starting at the head end of the body and 13 is going down towards the tail end of the body as you go down the length. And we were very interested in Hox 3, which in flies is called Zen. Although it's actually not needing...
Sounds very peaceful.
It does sound very peaceful, although it's actually not at all. But this was an interesting one of something that was different at a time when people were still more marveling at how conserved, how much the same everything was. And so the reason it's different is that Hox 3 in vertebrates, in fish, frogs, all of these, even in certain other things, say... in squid, others, has the job you would expect, and that it's kind of in between Hox 2 and Hox 4, and helps to make part of the body that's in the middle, but a little bit more towards the anterior head end.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not the case in insects, and it's not the case in the fruit fly. And so there is a gene at that position on this beads on the string model, but it doesn't have a job in making the embryonic body at all. It's still active during embryonic development, but it's active in some extra embryonic tissues or components that are outside of the embryo, inside of the egg. And so that's a completely different context, a completely different function. And we started out being very interested in when did this happen over evolutionary time and what is it doing in this new context?
Mm-hmm.
And initially what people knew was actually from one of these classical genetics mutant screens in the fruit fly. And so first Zen was known in the early 80s. And sadly, Zen has nothing to do with being peaceful or thinking of Buddhism and rock gardens and things like this. It's actually short for zerknüllt, which is the German word for crumpled or twisted, kind of the effect you'd get if you took a piece of paper and you balled it up or wadded it up in your hands.
Mm-hmm.
And in general, genes classically were named after their mutants, because it was the mutant that you saw, that was how you got interested in that particular gene without any prior knowledge. And so genes are kind of named backwards because they're named after the mutant, which is kind of the absence of that normal gene's function. And zerknüllt is not a very descriptive mutant. It just means that the embryo didn't look quite right and then wasn't able to hatch later on. Not very descriptive at all. But even though they knew where this gene was, and it was in the middle of all of these Hox genes, the sequence, the DNA, had changed so much that it wasn't until they started to do these comparative studies in grasshoppers and beetles that they realized that it's actually the fly relative, as it were, of this Hox 3. But when they started to look at the Zen or Hox 3 gene in beetles and in grasshoppers, they saw that this gene also was in this extra embryonic component, not in the embryo at all.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is very interesting, and I wanted to look at this a bit further. And so then...
Have you discovered what it's actually doing outside that embryo?
It's a little bit different. Things never stay the same. So there isn't even a single Zen gene and there isn't a single Zen function. But our thinking was, let's try and find out what's going on where we can block the gene and study it in a context that's not just the fruit fly. Because fruit flies, like many model organisms, actually have very strange developmental patterns. So they're extremely quick, small, and streamlined. And they don't have a lot of the more complicated features that normal embryos and normal eggs have.
Mm-hmm.
And so then it's a bit tricky because you don't have a normal embryo, but you have the power of all of the genetics that have been done over the last 80 odd years. And so then we decided to work on a species of bug. And for me, bug is a very technical term. It means a particular set of insects that already the little insect nymph that comes out of the egg looks quite like an adult. It doesn't have a caterpillar stage or a cocoon stage. And they feed by sucking. So similar to mosquitoes, but not related. And the ones I study feed on seeds. So they have a proboscis and they can suck the juices out of seeds, for example. Just a particular group of insects. But the reason that they're interesting is because at the time we started working on them, it turns out that they were very sensitive to a technique that was pretty new at the time called RNA interference.
Mm.
And that's very, very nice because if you don't have decades and decades of genetics behind you, you don't have a mutant that you can take for any gene you're interested in. There really are stock centers where you look through the equivalent of a library catalog digitally, you say, I'll take this mutant off the shelf, and you can actually ask for the stock center to send it to you. But that's only the case with Drosophila. And if you want to study a particular gene in another animal, then you have to go about it in a bit of a different way. And so RNA interference is very nice. It started to be known in the late 90s, and then it was just a few years ago that Nobel Prizes were awarded for understanding the mechanism behind it. But to get from the DNA information to the actual protein or other molecule that's doing the job in the cell, you have the RNA as an intermediate. The difference between DNA and RNA is just the structure of the sugar molecule and the fact that typically DNA is this double-stranded helix and RNA is a single strand. And so the RNA is the template that you use for actually making the structure that the gene is supposed to encode. Mm-hmm. And with RNA interference, you can, by knowing the specific sequence of your gene, use that to your advantage to completely block the activity of the gene. You haven't changed the DNA, there's no mutant, there's no hole in the genome, but you've blocked this transition from DNA to protein, and so it's the temporary equivalent of having a mutant. And it was first discovered kind of by accident, and mostly in C. elegans, this worm that has been worked on for biology studies a lot, and also in plants. And since the RNA is just one strand, it's only a copy of one half of the DNA. And so then they were trying to do some studies to suppress the function. And so they thought if the RNA is normally of, say, the right hand, if we stick the left hand in, then because they're complementary, they'll stick together and then nothing will happen. Mm-hmm. And so they made preparations of the right hand, let's say, to block it. And as a control, they had preparations of the left hand, which should, in a way, just give more of what you started with and shouldn't change anything. And they found that actually they're blocking the effect of the gene or of the RNA, whether you use the right hand or the left hand. And they couldn't figure this out. But when they looked a bit more carefully, it wasn't only a pure preparation of right hand or a pure preparation of left hand. It was a little bit of a mixture. Mm-hmm. And if you have right and left hands together because they're complementary, then they would kind of stick together. And so instead of this one-stranded molecule, you'd have two strands. And this is the trick that nobody had really realized. If you have a double-stranded RNA molecule, then there's machinery in the cells of the body to say, this molecule isn't right. Let's get rid of it. And so then you actually have machinery in the cells to destroy these molecules. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't only destroy the double-stranded molecule that you have. It can see what the sequence is inside of that double-stranded molecule and then go find any other single-stranded copies. Molecule mm-hmm. in the cell and say, oh, this is the same sequence. Let's get rid of this too. Mm-hmm. And so the effect spreads from the original left plus right-hand preparation to, say, all of the left, all of the right, everything that the cell had, even what should have been there in the first place. Mm-hmm. And the reason that this property exists is because a lot of viruses don't really have DNA. They work with only RNA. Mm-hmm. And when they've done an infection and when they're in the act of replicating, there is this step where there is a double-stranded RNA molecule. And so many animal cells and plant cells have this capacity to recognize these molecules.
So that's how they get rid of viruses.
Exactly.
And now it's time for Listener of the Episode. And today's Listener of the Episode is Ed from Melbourne in Australia. And he wants to pass on a hello to Sarah Grasmick over in the US. So thanks for listening, Ed.
But you can then take advantage of this property for doing your own studies, because mm-hmm. if you know the sequence of your gene and what you want to do is block it, then you can not just accidentally in an unpure preparation, but on purpose, make a solution that has these double-stranded molecules for the RNA, inject it, and then you can block the activity of your gene. So that's actually called reverse genetics. Classical genetics, you have no bias. You make lots of mutants, say, with irradiation, something like this. Mm-hmm. And then you see what you get, and then you say, this looks funny. Let's try and figure out what bit of DNA is affected. And reverse genetics goes from knowing the DNA that you want to affect, and then through this temporary mechanism, say of RNA interference, you can suppress the activity and then see what goes wrong to try and reconstruct what it's normally doing. So a little bit of an aside, but knowing that this technique of RNA interference works very well in the species of bug, we wanted to know what was happening with the HOX3 or the Zen gene. And We didn't expect too much. What we knew from fruit flies was that if you don't have this gene, that the very early embryo doesn't get all the information it needs to know what should be embryo and what should be this tiny little bit of extra embryonic tissue that just covers the yolk. But if you don't have this tiny bit of tissue, then you don't have all of the structural support that you need, and so later development is perturbed and you get this sucknut, twisted, crumpled up embryo or bit of paper. And so we thought that there would be some problem with this early patterning stage of development when the information is being laid down, the foundation or the basic blueprint, as it were, for making the body. And so I set about doing my first experiments a bit in the wrong way. And I did very careful staging every 4 hours of the very early stages of embryogenesis in the species of bug. And it turns out that there is a HOX3 zen gene, and it is active in the extra embryonic component, but it has nothing to do with early patterning at all. It's actually important about halfway through embryogenesis. And in the
What's
case
it doing
of
before
my,
that?
We don't see anything that it's really doing.
Okay.
You can see that it's expressed, but if you look at the embryos in a number of different ways, you don't see any defects whatsoever. But in this species, if you keep the eggs at 25 degrees, then it takes about a week for development to complete. And what happened and what seemed to be going wrong was some particular event happening about 4 days into development. And I had done all of my careful studies on things in the first few days, so no wonder I had missed it for the first while. And in bugs and many other insects, there isn't just this small extra embryonic component covering the yolk. It actually has two different extra embryonic membranes, and these are very elaborate membranes that are covering not just the yolk but also the embryo. And they have to develop. They are made of cells, same as the embryo, and then they have different capacities to grow over and cover the embryo, and then actually later on to contract away from the embryo to uncover it. But because they're also connected to the embryo, when they're contracting and things like this, they pull the embryo around, so the embryo is affected by these. And this ability to contract and to pull the embryo around was what was lost. And that doesn't sound like a very big deal. The embryo is still there. It's still growing inside of the egg. It still has its yolk. It still is growing the head and the legs and the abdomen and everything else. But the problem is that the early embryo is inside of the yolk. Mm-hmm. And especially in embryos that take some days to develop, you can think that this is good for protection or for some sort of cushioning or in a dry environment so that the egg is not getting too dried out, or if it's getting dried out on the outside, the embryo inside is still okay. The problem is that the yolk is the nutrition for development, mm-hmm. but typically it doesn't all get used up over the course of the period inside the egg. You still have a bit left over at the end, which is kind of a good idea. Mm-hmm. So what happens is later insects tend to grow so that they can grow their gut around the yolk. Mm-hmm. And at the time that they hatch, you can then see that the little hatchling insect has a bit of yolk already inside of its belly, as it were.
Okay.
But if it's inside of the yolk, bit of a difficult proposition
to actually
grow your
that.
Gut around the yolk, as it were.
Yeah.
And so the way that insects get out of the yolk is through the activity of these extra embryonic membranes.
Mm-hmm.
So at first they have this protective function around the embryo, around the yolk, but when the embryo is about halfway through and getting pretty old, the membranes have to contract and pull the embryo out of the yolk. And that doesn't happen when you block this HOX3 zen gene. So we had a very big surprise, because if you think that the gene is active early and giving the initial tissue identity information, you think, okay, maybe it doesn't have these membranes. And instead, it took us a little while to realize what's happening. And my first recording in my lab book of the observations on these RNA interference experiments was that I had some sort of necrotic zombies. Because I thought, well, maybe if I'm messing something with the gene, it'll take a bit longer for development to happen. I'll just leave them a little bit, give them a bit of a chance. And by the time I came to look at them, the tissue was starting to die inside of the egg.
Mm-hmm.
And the embryo was there in a very consistent pattern, but it looked really strange. And I had these tiny, tiny little bodies and all of this white stuff, and which I figured was the yolk still outside. What actually turns out to be the case is that if you can't get the embryo out of the yolk, they grow inside out. And so that means that this white stuff I saw outside of the little body was actually the organ tissue.
Okay.
Which normally is inside of the body. And this tiny little body that I did see didn't have any legs. It was this very smooth surface. But if I dissected this tiny little body open, the legs were inside. So I had something where the legs and the antennae were inside, and the brain, the ventral nerve cord, the central nervous system,
we're
the exocrine was outside. It was outside the right bit. So the brain was outside of the head and things like that, but completely inside out. The reason for that is because the way that you grow your gut and other things around the yolk is that you actually start from a relatively two-dimensional configuration, and then you grow up your sides kind of around an oval, as it were, to enclose the yolk. And so if you picture an oval or cylindrical shape of an egg, then you start with the tissue of the embryo on one side, the yolk, say, on top of that, and then you grow up around the yolk, and that's how the gut gets around the yolk gets inside.
Mm-hmm.
And this ability of the embryo to grow its body out and around is retained. But if it never gets out of the yolk, then it grows its body out and around inside, and it's stuck inside of these membranes. And so it's kind of stuck in this early configuration, and although the body is growing out and around, it does it in this inappropriate context, and you end up with this very strange inside-out embryo of a bug. It took me a little while to realize that that was what was going wrong and that this was the process that it was affected, but it turns out that this seems to be relatively conserved in other species of insects as well.
Sounds a bit...
not what we were expecting in the least.
Sounds scarier to look at than watching a Friday the 13th movie or something.
Well, I don't know. I think that once you understand what's happening, it doesn't look bad because all of the parts of the body are extremely well formed. They're just not in the right part. And so that compared to mutants, where one of the classical mutants in flies, again, is where you have legs growing out where the antennae should be, something like that. Looks a bit more like your classic bee horror movie, something like this.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess aesthetics are a bit of what you're used to.
So is there an equivalent to the Zen gene in humans?
There is, but going back to the fact that we are interested in a difference over evolutionary time, then it's still called HOX3.
Mm-hmm.
And HOX3 is then still doing the job of a HOX gene and giving information down the length of the body.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be technically anterior thoracic region. What that means is that it's giving information for, let's say, somewhere between the jaw and the shoulder, something like this.
Okay.
So if you didn't have the activity of this gene, then you would actually have a transformation, one of these homeotic transformation I was talking about, so that the information a bit farther down, so let's say your torso or so, would be conferred on that tissue, and you would lose some of the jaw or shoulder region of the body.
Okay.
Still not a very pleasant thing to contemplate, but nothing nearly as dramatic as being inside out.
So where do you see your research going? What do you want to try and achieve out of it?
Well, it's not where I thought it would go. At first, I was very interested in how molecular evolution works, and it was just embryology or development that was the context for these questions. And so I was very interested in this notion of changes in function over time and this original change from the HOX3 function to this Zen function in insects, where you're going from patterning the body to this extra embryonic component. But then I started to become more and more interested in embryos, and rather in how on earth do you get inside out? What are you supposed to do? Normally you're supposed to flip the body upside down and backwards and then change it again. And so I'm actually much more of a pure developmental biologist than I used to be.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than looking at how the genes give the patterning information, which is kind of like looking at how the DNA gives information in the first place, I'm rather more interested in what are these movements of tissues that are important for actually creating the body. Because the DNA is linear, and even if you have the activity of different genes in different places, you can imagine that giving kind of a coordinate system information, where is the head going to be, where is the abdomen going to be. But then that's still only, say, two-dimensional, and I'm interested rather in how the tissues are forming and how they move and how they shape themselves to create the body itself.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm much more interested in pure developmental biology and actually in the cell behaviors of these tissues than I used to be before. And I didn't expect that at all, but the gene was doing something in a time and place we didn't expect, and that turned out to be quite interesting.
That's always a good thing, isn't it? If something unexpected occurs, because then that makes you stop and think, gee, I wonder why that happened.
Yeah, certainly. And so hopping, I guess, from one Nobel Prize achievement to another, I started out by using this technique of RNA interference, which is extremely common in lots of biology research these days as a way of blocking gene activity. And now in being interested in the behavior of individual cells and tissues when they're moving, A very good way of doing this is actually for making movies, because development is very dynamic and it's taking place in four dimensions, and the time component is really important.
Mm-hmm.
And so rather than trying to look at a single time point, if you can make a movie and see context of before and after, that's really important. But if you want to know about a single cell in that context, then it's very good if you can see it. And so in this context, the use of green fluorescent protein as a technology for these studies is extremely powerful these days. Green fluorescent protein is originally from jellyfish, but
I've
it can
heard
be
about this one.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's a bit more of a recent award. And what you can do with it is you can effectively glue the GFP, the green fluorescent protein information, onto the protein that you're interested in studying. So you have a hybrid, and the GFP is pretty small, so it doesn't really affect the activity of what you're studying, but it means that what you're studying is then fluorescent and it's green. So it's mm-hmm. extremely easy to track where it's active and what's happening and things like that. And so the ability to make these fluorescent time-lapse movies is something that's increasingly common mm-hmm. in a number of different species. And so that seems to be both where my interests and a lot of the field are going these days.
Okay, so if listeners are interested in finding out more about this, where should they go?
For the technology, probably Google would be your best bet, because there'll be a lot of press releases at the moment. I can't think of anything in particular. But if it was rather more for the evolutionary side of things, an organization, a website I like very much, is simply called The Tree of Life.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a very nice way of just browsing through the diversity of plants and animals and fungi and everything.
Okay.
And so that actually is a very nice organization. And I guess that is at tollweb.org or something like this. So Tree of Life, T-O-L.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you very much for your time today and joining me on the show.
You're very welcome. It was my pleasure.
Ah, well, if only I had the money, I'll make it to Germany one day. Just a reminder to everyone, I've put a note up on the Brains Matter website asking what your favourite episode for 2009 was. So please fill that in, let me know what your favourite episode was, and I'll mention the results of that early in the new year. In the meantime, let's listen to some listener feedback. First up, we've got Richard. He comments, I recently found this podcast and have to say you cover a wide variety of subjects. I've been listening to the past episodes and find almost all of them interesting. I'm looking forward to more in the future. Stem cells and genetics are an interesting subject for me. Thanks for the info posted. Well, thanks for that, Richard. Shauna wrote in reference to episode 101, the interview with Dr. Paul Francis on comets and pink black holes, or just one sentence, oh my god, quasars. I think there's a bit of a story behind that. Thanks for that, Shauna. Mike McClure, who's in Portland in the US, wrote in and said, I've been catching up on the BM podcast since I've been going to the gym more. Thanks for all your hard work putting it together. I think it's awesome that you've dedicated so much time and effort to doing it, and we appreciate it. I just listened to number 68 on fictional scientists. On the question of Batman, and possibly Iron Man, there's a difference between scientists and engineers. I would definitely class Batman as an engineer. Just going through my collections, there was also Ash from Aliens. Okay, so he's an android, but still. Daniel Oliver, likewise an android, but from the Foundation series. Dr. Herbert West from The Reanimator. Dr. Theopolis from Buck Rogers. Dr. Daniel Jackson from Stargate. Better still, Dr. Rodney McKay from Stargate Atlantis. The Doctor is certainly the most prolific scientist. Dr. Suresh from Heroes. Trillian from Hitchhiker's Guide and an astrophysicist, even. Chris Knight from Real Genius, a personal favourite. Dr. Julie Parrish from V, the original series. And then there's plenty much the entire cast of the series Eureka. Mike. Wow, there's a lot of great suggestions there, Mike, and I'm sure that all the people at home are going to start looking them up right now. Reese Winter from Australia wrote in and said, Hi, ordinary guy. Just wanted to drop you an email to say congratulations on the 3 years' worth of shows. I've been a big fan since learning of your podcast when you had your first 365 Days of Astronomy podcast. With all the science astrophysics podcasts I listen to, I can't believe I've missed one of the best and from my own hometown. Keep up the great work. Also, just in case it interests you, listening to your show and hearing your sponsor tipped me over the edge to sign up for the Masters in Astronomy. That will take me a few years to complete, so I look forward to listening to more of your shows that will better my understanding of the modules I have waiting for me. Cheers, Reese Winter. I'm really glad you're enjoying the show, Reese, and best of luck with your study. I know it's a lot of hard work. Shantanu Baidkamkar from India wrote in and said, "Hi OG, heartiest congratulations on the occasion of your third anniversary. Look forward to hearing some more great interviews, Shantanu." Well, thanks for those wishes, Shantanu, and I hope you enjoy the next 3 years of Brains Matter. Harold Goldner from Pennsylvania in the US wrote in and said, "I love your podcast. I've been following a little less than a year and download almost every one of your podcasts. I learned about you via your first 365 Days of Astronomy podcast. Keep up the great work. Just finished listening to the second part of Dr. Prentice's interview on Model Laplacian Theory, number 94. Pretty interesting, and I'm just a neophyte without any mathematical background. Signed, Harold." Well, thanks for that, Harold. Frank Krismos writes in relation to episode 88, Binary Star Formation, "I remember back when protoplanets were first confirmed, questions were asked whether they could form around binaries, and if so, what kind of orbits they might have. People were very disappointed to learn that figure 8 orbits were pretty much impossible." Aha. Well, you're absolutely right. Robin wrote in response to one of the posts on the website, which had a comparison of astronomical sizes, and said, "Love these pictures. They're so impressive, and every time I look at them, they make me gasp with the sizes of the stars and the universe." Thanks for that, Robin. Martin from Canada wrote in and said, "Hi from Canada. Just found your podcast through a link from AstronomyCast and have only listened to one episode so far, your 100th show, which had so many cool highlight topics that I'm looking forward to listening to your archive. Thanks, and all the best in the forthcoming year." Thanks for that, Martin, and I hope you do enjoy going back through the back catalogue. Let me know what you think. And finally, Adrian Lee wrote in response to the post that I put up on the website asking listeners to tell me what your favourite episode was. And Adrian wrote and said, "I'd have to say that episode 90 on nanotechnology was the best of all the podcasts on Brains Matter this year. The technology that was discussed was very thought-provoking, proving that as a species, there's so much more we need to explore. Keep it up, OG." Thanks for that, Adrian, and I hope you enjoy the shows for next year.
Have you ever wondered why it supposedly took God 7 days to create the world? I mean, if you're God, why not just do it in one day? Have you ever thought that some religions have too much influence on our society, that laws should be based on rational thought and evidence and not unprovable personal beliefs? The Global Atheist Convention will be held in Melbourne in March 2010. It will be the largest gathering of atheists, rationalists, skeptics, freethinkers, and other like-minded people in Australia's history. The presenter list is incredible and includes Richard Dawkins, author of The God Delusion, Catherine Devaney, comedian and regular writer in Melbourne's The Age newspaper, and P.Z. Myers, author of the world's top-ranked science blog, Ferengula, plus many more. This is a unique opportunity to hear from remarkable presenters and meet other people who just might think about religion and society the same way you do. Don't miss out. Go to atheistconvention.org.au for more information and tickets. We'll see you in Melbourne.
And now it's time to get an expert to answer a question from a listener. Now we've got a question from Dan Jackson in Sydney. Dan asks, "I have a stupid question. Say a shuttle is flying through space and it's continually burning its rockets. Would it not continue to accelerate even past the speed of light due to no drag on the shuttle? If nothing slows it down, why is it said that we can't travel at or accelerate to the speed of light? I do know that no matter what speed you travel, light will travel away from you at the speed of light, but the question still stands." And to answer this question, I've got Richard Stancliffe from Monash University here to answer. So welcome to the show again.
Thank you very much. Good to be back. Okay, so I guess the problem with this one is there's a little bit more in special relativity than just the standard results that you usually hear about, so the time dilation and length contraction. Special relativity also tells us, very importantly, that mass and energy are equivalent.
Mm-hmm. So this is Einstein's MC squared.
The very famous E equals MC squared. So the problem here is as we accelerate our rocket, as we burn our fuel, we're giving the whole the rocket more and more kinetic energy.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually, when we get to very, very fast speeds, that means effectively we're making, when we give energy to the rocket, we're actually making it more and more massive.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if that E becomes greater, C squared is a constant, the M must increase. And so that means that in order to accelerate our rocket, we would have to burn more and more fuel.
Mm-hmm.
And so it basically becomes a law of diminishing returns, that the more massive our object would get, the more fuel we would have to burn. And if you took it to the limit that we actually got, the closer and closer we get to the speed of light, the closer we have to getting a body, at least in our frame, that we're talking about, that its mass would be increasing so much that the mass would be getting infinite and we'd require an infinite amount of fuel.
So effectively the fuel tank on that rocket would have to be as big as the universe.
Pretty much. So that's why we can't actually accelerate up into the speed of light.
All right. Well, Dan, I hope that answers your question. And thanks for asking it. And thank you, Richard.
No problem. Glad to help.
Well, Dan, I hope that answered the question for you. And if anyone else has any questions, feel free to send them through. I'll leave you with a quote attributed to the CEO of Nintendo. Video games don't affect kids. If Pac-Man had affected us as kids, we'd all be running around in darkened rooms, munching magic pills, and listening to repetitive electronic music. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the BrainsMatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right-hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.